Good evening and welcome to Aware on the Air, an unrehearsed panel discussion of the U.S. government's wars and the racism they inspire. We're recording this at noon on Tuesday, November 15th, in the studios of Urbana Public Television, Urbana, Illinois. Our program is presented by members and friends of Aware, a local peace group. The name Aware stands for Anti-War, Anti-Racism Effort. I'm Carl Osterbrook. Members and friends of Aware work to expose the news media's inadequate account of the vicious war-making for which the U.S. government is responsible. Like all American presidents for more than a generation, President Obama is today making war around the world. And now his administration is threatening Russia with war in Syria and beyond. Since World War II, U.S. presidents have killed more than 20 million people in 37 nations. The U.S. remains, during the Obama administration, what Martin Luther King called it long ago, the greatest purveyor of violence in the world today. When his term ends in 2 months, Barack Obama will have become the first U.S. president ever to have been at war throughout 2 presidential terms. He has attacked 8 countries, 2 more than George Bush, and he is today conducting what has been called the most extreme terrorist campaign of modern times, his drone assassinations. He has killed thousands of civilians with drones, including U.S. citizens and hundreds of children. The New York Times says he chooses the targets himself from lists prepared by the CIA. In addition to conducting wars throughout the Mideast, the Obama administration is acting with belligerence towards China and promoting an ongoing proxy war against Russia in Ukraine. That war has already killed more people than Israel killed, with U.S. permission, in Gaza in 2014. The president is risking war with both Russia and China, even nuclear war. He also commands a 70,000-member private army, the Special Operations Command, active in more than 130 countries. Their activities include kidnapping, we call it rendition, murder, and torture. Not only is the Obama administration risking nuclear war, they're preparing for it. President Obama has launched a 10-year, trillion-dollar program to update nuclear weapons and make them more usable. The Obama administration is also responsible for the vicious civil war in Syria, which has killed thousands and flooded Europe with refugees. Why has our government plagued the world with war for more than 2 generations? The answer is simple and horrible: to protect the profits of the 1%, the American economic elite. When World War II ended in 1945, the U.S. was the only undamaged major country and controlled the world economy for the benefit of that 1%. In all the years since, U.S. administrations have been willing to kill people and make war to, quote, maintain the disparity, close quote, as American planners put it. The Mideast has been a particular concern of the U.S. government because of its vast stock of oil and natural gas. The U.S. doesn't need oil from the Mideast, but Mideast gas and oil are needed by America's economic competitors in Europe and Asia. So control over them gives the U.S. a chokehold over China, Germany, and other countries. But that control benefits only the American economic elite, that 1%, and not Americans in general, who've seen wealth concentrate in fewer and fewer hands at an accelerating rate throughout the Clinton, Bush, and Obama administrations. Obama was elected twice because the generally anti-war U.S. public understood him to say that he would end George Bush's wars. But he was lying. In office, Obama moved massively to expand Bush's war in Afghanistan, and as he leaves office, he promises 10,000 U.S. troops will stay there, along with mercenaries and coalition forces, he means NATO, and U.S. subversion of other countries in MENA, the Mideast and North Africa, continues apace. In a book on the last presidential campaign, he's quoted as follows: "Turns out I'm really good at killing people," Obama said quietly. "Didn't know that was going to be a strong suit of mine." However ironically he meant it, the quote was not denied by the White House, and it turns out to be true. Hillary Clinton, responsible for horrors in Honduras, Libya, Syria, and elsewhere, as president would have only continued and intensified the warmongering of the Bush and Obama administrations, the blowback from which is now producing terrorist attacks in Europe and America. She made quite clear in her campaign, those who voted for her were voting for expanded warfare in the Middle East and probably military confrontation with Russia elsewhere as well. Clinton is both a neoliberal, which means more inequality, and a neoconservative, which means more war. But interestingly enough, Donald Trump isn't. If Trump can stick to his campaign promises, he will find solid and reliable partners in Russian President Putin, in spite of the Democrats' lying portrait of Putin, and Chinese President Xi Jinping. Neither Russia nor China have anything at all to gain from a confrontation with, or even less, a conflict with, the United States. Will President-elect Trump have the wisdom to realize this and use it for the benefit of the U.S.? AWARE, like other anti-war groups across the country, demands that President Trump, one, establish a foreign policy based on diplomacy, international law, and human rights, two, end the wars in the Mideast and elsewhere, and stop the drone attacks, three, cut military spending by at least 50%, and close the more than 700 foreign military bases. Neither Russia nor China has more than a dozen. Four, stop U.S. support and arms sales to human rights abusers, notably Israel and the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And five, lead on global disarmament. There's a lot of news about U.S. government war making this week, but you won't hear much about it in the American media. We'll mention some of it tonight, beginning with Karen Arum.
Well, like most people, this week was quite a surprise. I have to admit, I was quite shocked, Carl. I never agreed with you that Trump had any chance of winning this election. So you were right on that.
Not as right as Ed, but he'll tell us
right,
about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, right. I was equally as shocked at the outrage over his election. I mean, this was a Democratic election. We call ourselves a democratic society. We shove that down people's throats and use it as an excuse for our interventions and our false flags around the world that, well, we have to bring them democracy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so I mean, it was quite a shock. And let me say this, I know for a fact that there's no question in my mind that there were some of the, what we call pseudo-left groups out there fomenting a lot of this. But there were also a lot of Hillary people, but a lot of it was genuine, this mass hysteria that we saw. My concern was, why are you out there protesting and demonstrating before the guy has even taken office? You're only demonstrating against the results of the election, which you don't like. That is not in keeping with democracy. On the other hand, I have been led to believe that no, it really is people expressing their fear and outrage, which has been fomented. And some of it, I think, is correct, rightful, but a lot of it is not. My thinking was simply, let's wait until he's made his cabinet appointments. That will be very telling. And then we go forward later on, and what we need to do is organize and protest against the issues. We've got to really focus on the issues. My concern is that while we need to unite the people against the establishment that has been doing all of the things, Carl, that you've been talking about, but what we're actually getting is a civil war, and that only serves the purpose of the oligarchs that are running our country. Now, I'm not capable right now of suggesting what people should do as far as organizing and working within their communities, since I don't have much experience on that. My focus has generally been anti-war and reaction to specific issues. But I think that's where we have to go. That's the suggestions that most people have made. I liked what say his name for me. I don't say it correctly. I don't have any notes that I posted this morning. I saw him interviewed. He Slavoj Žižek.
Zizek, I think. As close as I can come.
Yeah,
Slavoj Zizek.
Yeah, yes. He's a counterpart to Noam Chomsky.
Counterpart is a little.
Maybe that's
they
wrong.
Hate each other, but.
Yeah. Yeah. But he actually was a
but
Greek.
But you're not wrong.
He's a, I guess, a rival to Noam Chomsky.
A rival, that's what.
That's a better. Yeah, he's a rival. But he was actually agreeing with Chomsky during the interview today. And basically, he was saying what a lot of people have been saying, what I have been saying the past week, is that the good that may come out of this is the fact that it has awakened people to politics. People, like my daughter, who were never interested in politics, even if they're, it's like suddenly they're waking up to what is so awful going on, and they're starting to take notice. And maybe this will be a learning experience, if nothing else. Because people were asleep during the Obama administration. And if Hillary had been elected, they would go right back to sleep and not notice all of the wars and all of the things that were happening. I mean, here's an example. People are so in fear and outraged over the fact that Trump has said he will first act is deport something like 1.2 million immigrants. Primarily undocumented immigrants. Well, Obama has already deported 3 million, okay? The difference is, under the Democratic administration, and it would have been the same if Hillary had gotten into power, make no mistake, it's a slow, quiet, covered over action. Under Trump, it's right there in your face. He's very direct. He tells you what he's gonna do.
Right.
And you know it, and then people get outraged. Now, the outrage is legitimate for a lot of these things. But I also think we have to really look at why was he elected. Here again, people weren't noticing that across much of mid-America, so many people lost their homes, lost their jobs, lost their opportunities to educate their children, lost just about everything that they'd ever worked for or hoped for. Pensions have been lost. I mean, most of mid-America has been literally so decimated. I'm not sure that's the correct word. So when you do this to a people, you have to expect that they're going to rise up and say, we need change. And I think too many people, specifically those living on the West Coast, the East Coast, who have been probably living a more comfortable life, fail to take notice, just as they fail to take notice of the wars across the nation, across the world. I mean, where have all these protesters been? I mean, good people, kind people, many of them. Where were they when we were bombing and killing women and children in the millions? Whether we were destroying Libya, whether we were destroying Syria. Look at the refugees flooding Europe. We are responsible for that, whether it's through our allies, whether it's through the weapons that we've sold. And again, I don't want to keep going over the same thing you've been going over, Carl. But this is why I'm saying we have a situation now where I see it as frightening, given some of the cabinet appointments. Bannon, who what I've read, and I never knew anything about him before, for his, what is it, the White House strategist. The fear of John Bolton, I mean, having him as the Secretary of State?
He's been mentioned as a possible Secretary of State.
Now,
yes.
We still don't have confirmation yet.
No.
So I don't want to push any more hysteria than what needs to be. What I do want to comment on here, Carl, that I know you want to hear from me, hold on one moment, is Asia. We've had Pepe Escobar, somebody who I've quoted, read his articles endlessly in the past 3.5 years, saying that maybe the pivot to Asia is over now. I don't think that's true. I think it does depend on what Trump does under these circumstances. If he implements tariffs on goods being imported back into the U.S., of course, my first question is, it's going to be passed on to the consumer. How can the consumer then afford to pay for them? But it is going to create problems with China. Now, whether or not he will act on that, it gets complicated. But when people were saying, and a lot of people, not just Pepe Escobar, have been saying, well, the pivot to Asia is over, because they're looking at the Asian nations. For instance, right now in South Korea, there has been a lot of protest and anger and demonstrators against the current president of South Korea. But it's over THAAD, T-H-A-A-D, which is our military system that the U.S. has been trying to set up there. And then add to that a personal scandal that she is now involved in. And as a result, the people are opposed to her. And she is definitely a U.S., let's just say she's a U.S. puppet, and leave it at that. So that's South Korea. I've been talking about Thailand since their coup and before their coup of 2014. And bottom line, they've been moving closer to China while still playing both sides. Philippines has Duterte, the president there, has come out and spoken out against the U.S. and told us to remove our military bases from the south. I think he's given us a couple years to remove the ones from the north. So even though a lot of Asia watchers think that this is very positive, and it means that all of our Asian allies, excuse me, are now moving away from the U.S., moving towards China, yes, they are. But they're still just playing both sides. And I do not believe for a moment that the U.S. pivot to Asia has ended yet. I think that we have to be very vigilant because there's no guarantees of anything. So I'm not jumping, and I think that what we're seeing in Asia right now, the anti-Americanism, is really due to things that have been taking place now over the past year or so as a result of our actions, and doesn't necessarily have anything to do with a new President Trump in power. What he will do or what his administration will do is very important, and a lot has to do with his appointments. Now, the one positive appointment that I've heard of, speculation, is that he might appoint General Michael Flynn, former retired General Michael Flynn, as his NSA advisor, and that he has been an advisor. And Flynn, so I read up on him in Politico.
Yeah, thinking that may not be the best place.
Right, but thinking that he was an anti-war candidate, my concern here again is that, okay, he seems to be opposed to perpetual war. That's a good thing. That's
obviously
a good
thing. Crazy, yeah.
Well, he's been treated as if he was crazy.
He certainly has.
His thinking is that he knows that we're not trying to win the war against ISIS. I think that in itself is positive. He recognizes that the U.S. is not trying to win the war with ISIS. And so if he is appointed, there's a very good chance that he may just want to go ahead and end the war. Now, here again, how is he going to go about doing that? What will his views be on Russia? I have no information on that yet, Carl. Maybe you know more. But I think it's his views on provocations with Russia and his views on NATO and his views on the South China Sea. We know already Trump is sort of backing away from defunding NATO. That's not a good thing. But was that just Obama saying that? So at this point, I don't know where we are.
I think a lot of us don't know where we are, and I think that's, for some people at least, that's the design, that's the end, that's what they're trying to make known. I mean, as you suggested, and I think it's right, the real talent of the Obama administration has been to distract people from what they're doing, particularly when it comes to killing people.
Right.
I mean, the wars have expanded under Obama, and most Americans don't know it, not because they're stupid, but because there is a consummate propaganda campaign being carried on by the Obama administration to obfuscate what they're doing. It's worked nicely.
Right.
Go ahead, Ed.
I was actually going to react to the NATO comment that I personally actually like the idea of the NATO possibly being defunded and challenged.
Well, yeah, I do too.
I mean, I want it to be challenged, and I think its authority. I mean, it was originally the North American, North Atlantic, you know, treaty organization, and that was expanded into something where into areas was never given the originally supposed to go. And I think it should be challenged. And I think a lot of the old some of these organizations that have existed for years should be challenged. And,
well, that was one of the positives that Trump was talking about.
Right. Yeah. And I'm actually more optimistic than you are that this administration will challenge a lot of old ideas. And I was going to mention that.
But he's already backed away from it. That's the problem. It appears Trump has already backed away from defunding NATO. Well, that's what we don't know.
Right.
Yet. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
We should point out that you are watching Aware on the Air. Carl Estabrook, Karen Arum, and Ed Mandel, our colleague with a prophetic grace this week. Ed, I think, not only called the election, but I think you came pretty close to calling the number of electoral votes,
I called 300. And yeah, exactly. I think he actually did get the 300 there.
I just hope you got a bet down somewhere.
I didn't get the bet down. I guess I didn't lose any money.
Your gift of prophecy was showing. So how do you speak now, O prophet?
Well, there you go. I'm actually more optimistic that this administration will be better than you think you will be. I can understand your concerns that it is sort of like, in certain ways, it seems to be the continuation of previous administrations. But I think in many ways, I think he's challenging a lot of authority in many ways. And I think maybe this is sort of like a learning in progress that he's going to, maybe he's going to challenge his own advisors at certain times. I don't know. But I believe that this will be different than previous administrations in many ways. I think one of the things that Trump is going to do is he's going to go back in time and challenge a lot of things that previous administrations have done, going all the way back to the, as I was going to mention this, you know, further along. I think he's going to go all the way back to Woodrow Wilson and challenge the Fed. I mean, not the Fed. I mean, He's going to go all the way back to Woodrow Wilson and challenge different things that have been existing for many years in many ways. What am I thinking of there? I'm sorry. But he's going to challenge different. And I think it's important. A lot of the things that have existed for many years. He's going to challenge. And I guess that's the reason why I mentioned the Fed. I hope he will have the Fed finally audited, which I think he will carry out during his administration. I believe it will happen. Then you mentioned about the election itself. But Trump is right now being protested. Well, you have to remember that Bush was protested also right before he got into office. So it seems to be an ongoing thing that every Republican seems to be protested, at least recently, for different reasons. Their legitimacy of their administration is being protested before they get into office. So that seems to be a tradition, I guess. I believe this may upset you. I don't know, but I believe he is going against the illegal immigration. I guess it's now what the preferred term is, undocumented immigration. I would assume that the labor movement is actually would, to some degree appreciate this, because to a certain degree, illegal immigration was taking away my jobs. And I was kind of bewildered when I asked a few people whether the labor movement supported Trump, and they mentioned they supported Hillary Clinton in the election, and I personally didn't understand that, because to a certain degree, to a larger degree, Trump was more pro-labor than Hillary was. It wasn't even close.
Exactly.
Hillary Clinton was more globalist and taking away losing jobs, and I didn't understand that at all. So labor movements. I kind of think maybe the labor vote, at least the labor voters, disagree with their own leaders and voted for Trump.
I think you put your finger on a crucial point, Ed. I really do.
And I didn't understand that at all. I'm sorry. And I was going to mention that the. Okay, so you've mentioned any number of times your problems with the 1%. And I was going to mention this, that, I mean, to a certain degree, I sort of understood it, but I didn't entirely agree with it. But now, there is a 1%, billionaire's 1% that I could agree with you on. And this might be a new idea for you guys, but in Silicon Valley, there are a lot of billionaires who are making profits off of robots that are replacing jobs. Mm-hmm. And they're replacing a lot of jobs. I mean, and apparently this 1%, we should be concerned about, is because they're replacing, for instance, I wrote down here, they're replacing, for instance, medical jobs and trucking jobs. I mean, apparently trucking, there's a lot of trucking jobs in the different states. And you're going to have trucks that are with no drivers.
Exactly.
It's a lot of their, and so it's kind of interesting that these billionaires, they don't care. These particular billionaires are more concerned about profits, and it's the bottom line. So here, actually, there is I agree with you that I'm kind of hoping that Trump can figure out a way to go back in time. And here, how do I put this? One of the things I've done personally is I've stopped watching television about 6 years ago, and I'm mentioning this, and I don't have a Twitter account, and I'm mentioning this because I think sometimes less technology is better, and I'm mentioning this because I'm not influenced by propaganda that comes through television. I'm not as influenced by the technology that comes through intimidation by other people through Twitter accounts and things like that. And I think sometimes going faster is not necessarily better. And I'm mentioning this too because, I mean, our technology seems to be pushing us that more is better, faster is better, more technology is better. And because we're going faster and more technology, people are actually losing jobs because of that. Because we're moving in different ways.
Right.
And so I'm thinking sometimes faster is not necessarily better for either for communities, which different technologies are destroying in different ways. And so I'm mentioning this as an all-inclusive thing, which I haven't fully investigated, but I'm just throwing this idea out at you that sometimes faster and more is not necessarily better for either for jobs or for communities in general. And another thing I was going to mention here is I noticed that Facebook and Google has another thing where they're going against ads against organizations that put up fake websites and fake news.
Yeah,
and I'm kind of wondering about that because here our own government puts up fake news and disinformation all the time. Would that mean that Facebook and Google are going to go against the government? I don't know. Probably not. But I'm just going to throw that out there that I haven't noticed that they're going against fake news and fake media and different websites like
It'd
that.
It'd be dangerous if it weren't so funny. I mean, I'm waiting for someone to say we got to get CNN, to take off the fake news.
Really. If you
extend this, maybe it's arguable. It's clearly the most anti-free speech move from these major corporations. Like Google and Facebook that we've seen in a while.
It seems as if they're doing this supposedly because they were angry about the results of the election.
Well,
but I think that's a phony reason for going against them. I mean, that's they should be going against.
I think you're right.
Different media sources and also their own government, but they're not going to do that for them. Whatever. Let's see. I was just going to wrap up and say that I there's one interesting idea I have written down here is I hope that Trump. Among his other thing, which I'm much more favorable about that, he will do a lot of things that are good. I believe he will. I think he will re-examine very seriously Obamacare and which I believe is a disaster right now, and it needs to be re-examined and revisited tremendously. I think he will do it. I think it will be revamped quite a bit. He will go again. He will challenge. In a strange way, he would be challenging Republicans over TPP.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's kind of interesting that he will be siding with the Democrats, apparently, when he signs that.
Because
apparently the Democrats were more favorable of the TPP than the Republicans are. So here he'll actually be crossing the party lines and actually be going in, siding with the Democrats against the Republicans and challenging that. And I think in many ways, I think he'll be. I see Trump as being a deal maker, or a person who wants to negotiate, and that's how I perceive him. And I think he'll be negotiating with the other side rather than listening to his advisors, without criticizing even their advice. So I think he will not. It will not be an empty suit. I think he will be challenging in different ways. I'm much more optimistic that this administration will be a good one, and apparently I don't know if I'm I guess I'm I know I probably I think I do know I'm at odds with both of you that about that.
Your credentials as a prophet are in good shape right
yeah.
now, so I hope you're right.
Okay, I will end it there. I don't want to take too much more time. No.
Thank you, Ed. You're watching Aware on the Air. We're talking about the events of the week. Our focus is primarily war, the war that the U.S. is carrying on really around the world, but obviously that is bound up with the local political events of the last week and so, as my colleagues have pointed out here. But our task for the last half of the show is to go back over some of the things that are said that have been said already and make some comments on them. I want to start with Karen's observation that there's a connection, obviously, with the vote for Donald Trump and the Brexit vote, the vote to leave the European Union in Britain. I think that's right, and that was highlighted by a somewhat surprising source just today. President Obama is on a trip to a number of places around the world. Was designed, obviously, as a sort of victory and valedictory address at the end of his term, and it's taken on a slightly different character with the fact that he will be succeeded not by Hillary Clinton, apparently, but by Donald Trump. Although, you know, I wake up in the middle of the night with the notion that the Clintons are going to make a run at the Electoral College.
I think that right now Obama's concerned about his legacy also.
Well, yes.
I think Trump is going to wipe out his legacy question.
Well, it's a question, it seems to me, of what Obama thinks his legacy is.
Yeah.
I mean, and as you pointed out, the open question about what the new administration will do with it. I think that's right.
I think Obama's going to be established as an empty suit.
As what?
As an empty suit.
As an empty suit. Yeah.
That's how I perceive.
Well, he's being greeted by Greeks in Greece today by a lot of protest, mm-hmm. and rightfully so. So I was hoping you would comment on that, Carl.
Well, I wanted to start with his observation in Greece that the vote for Trump was similar to the vote for Brexit. That is, he recognizes the way in which the protests that both of you mentioned as behind the election of Donald Trump is, in a sense, a worldwide phenomenon. We haven't got a very good set of terms to deal with it right now. The word populism has been much used, mm-hmm. but it's mainly been used by the American political establishment to denigrate something that that is obviously a threat to it. And that doesn't lead us to very clear understanding, I think, in many cases. And to try to disentangle the language from the nefarious purposes of the people who are using it is very difficult indeed. I'm sympathetic a little to Ed's notion that, you know, turn off the television because that's where you're getting this stuff from.
Yeah.
But let's think for a minute about this idea of what's being said about populism.
Nobody would watch the show.
In the popular discussion that we get over mainstream media and so forth, populism has become essentially synonymous with fascism. Another word that has been ripped out of the context of the early 20th century when it had a fairly specific meaning and applied in general to views that the political establishment doesn't like or sees as threatening. Now, there's a germ of truth in that. People draw parallels between the disorder in the worldwide economy, including the U.S. economy, of the present decade and that of the 1930s. Once again, as Mark Twain is supposed to have said, history doesn't repeat itself, but it does rhyme. There are similarities. But unfortunately, I think the similarities have been mobilized by the political establishment to denigrate its critics. And therefore we get the notion that the very different criticisms of the political establishment throughout the capitalist world are all just a manifestation of regrettable populism and distasteful fascism. I don't think that's right.
Okay, I'm going to go to something, I'm going to jump around here a bit.
There's so much going on right now, I'm having trouble keeping up. Comments on Obamacare, what Trump will do with Obamacare. If he introduces single-payer health care, that's definitely a plus that people will certainly gravitate towards. But if
you think
he just,
there's any chance of that?
Well, he made statements at one time that he would do this.
I would say no.
But I don't know. If he just does away with Obamacare, now he has indicated he wouldn't do away with the whole thing because there are certain people who would suffer terribly if he
did.
So what that would mean, does that give more power to the insurance companies, or is he going to actually implement something that would help people out? Because the fact of the matter is health care costs are rising significantly, and something needs to be done about that.
They're rising significantly because those insurance companies are doing very nicely, thank
exactly.
you.
Exactly. Now, Medicare. Is he going to cut Medicare? There have been indications that he would. What I keep coming back to, though, is so was Hillary. It's in the WikiLeaks emails that that was one of the things she was going to begin to, but she would do it on a probably on a slower basis, which is already happening to us, okay?
Exactly.
Medicare costs are going up, maybe only a few dollars at a time, while Social Security costs are not, Social Security benefits are not going up. I think it's 1% this year or something. So here again, whittling away of Medicare, that tends to be what the Democrats have been doing, whittling away of Social Security, which is something else that we know was in the planning stage by Hillary if she had been elected. Now,
we can't blame it all. We can't blame it all on Hillary either.
Right,
I mean,
right.
Remember,
Obama's been doing
in the middle of the Obama administration, there was much effort to produce what the Obama administration itself called the grand bargain. They had that commission which examined entitlements, and the plan clearly was to put together some sort of general program that would do for the things you're talking about what Bill Clinton did for welfare. And welfare as we know it. The Obama administration wanted to use its talents for obfuscation to cut what already misnamed, the language is already colonized, already misnamed entitlements, that is the social supports that, that do exist, Social Security and Medicare. Now, that was clearly a goal of the Obama administration. They didn't get as far with it as they wanted to, but and therefore we heard a lot more about it. A roundabout from Hillary, who wasn't so good at masking her her desires as Obama was.
Right, but the mainstream Americans out there, if they weren't paying attention, didn't recognize
that.
They just know that, oh, it's probably going to happen with Trump. Well, we don't know yet. Will it happen? I fear it might.
I think it will depend a great deal on whether there is a conscious demand on the part of the populace for a proper resolution of this. Anyone who looks at it knows that all civilized countries have some sort of free medical care, some system of free medical care, except for the United States.
Exactly.
And you can't hide that too much longer in order to guarantee the profits of the insurance companies.
I want to finish on that. As a member of the Green Party, I would like to mention that I recognized when a question came up at the Student Greens debate with libertarians that they had on campus. I wasn't there, so I don't know what happened, but I've been led to believe that there was no real answer to the question of what about Social Security. Now, I know that the platform of the Green Party currently is that, no, we don't want to privatize. In other words, we don't want Wall Street losing it the way they've lost pensions. We don't want to raise the weight or the age limit, which I think currently is 65 to like 72 or something, which is what's been promoted by many. That's
but who's that
good
old?
Enough.
Come on.
But that's not good enough for young people. Right. Young people, even if you tell them, don't worry, Social Security is funded until such and such a time, I look at the erosion that has taken place since Social Security was initially implemented to the point where if you're not paying into it, you're not going to collect it. So what is it? What is out there for people? So young people who are coming out of school with no jobs, they're coming out, and as you were referring to, the fact that we are going to become more mechanized with the advent of robots taking over jobs all the time, there may not be any jobs. Our major product today, if it isn't our military weapons, it's financial services. So what are all these young people coming out who may not have jobs going to do? Carl has often talked about the implementation of a, not a minimum wage, but a
universal basic income
that they were going to try out, I think, in Switzerland.
There have been a number of experiments, including in Canada,
and various experiments
along this line.
But what I would like to do, and I have suggested to other Greens, is that we need to really look at this and we need to implement into the Green Party platform for future generations something that would allow what you have suggested and what David Johnson has suggested takes place in other nations where they have a single-payer health care program, because I don't think we're meeting the needs of the younger generations. Now, I also want to point out jobs. That is, I think, the main reason why many who voted for Donald Trump
was the
fact that he has talked about bringing jobs back to America.
Right.
Whether he can accomplish that or not is questionable. But we know for a fact that one of the ways you create jobs, they're doing it in China, they've been doing it elsewhere, is infrastructure projects.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I saw Michael Hudson, he's an economist, and he has been saying, I saw him being interviewed on RT, and he was saying even Hillary had talked about infrastructure projects. Well, does she really mean it or not? But he's also said it depends on how the infrastructure projects are handled. Are they going to be union? Are they going to be union wages? Are they going to privatize it? And I think he was saying that he feared that Hillary would probably, under a Hillary regime, they would probably implement what they call privatization of the infrastructure projects, which would likely mean cost plus. Now, under cost plus, I think most people know that is what Halliburton or Halliburton's construction arm, which was actually KBR, whereby the federal government is paying $800 for a hammer, that this would not solve any problems. Yeah, you'd put people to work, but at such a huge cost that only the private companies, the corporations, would profit from it.
Can I just ask one question? I mean, you interrupted your train of thought here, but so in other words, Hillary, had she been elected, she would have privatized that.
He was suggesting that that was the possibility. He was suggesting that it's important that if we do infrastructure projects, whoever is in charge, that they be public options. And he suggests looking at not the economists that we've been looking at, you know, Krugman, one of them. He suggests that we look at what he calls modern economic theory. Bill Black, who's with Kansas.
Monetary theory, right?
Monetary theory, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Who is with Kansas University, or what they call, it's the Missouri University. It's in Kansas City, Missouri. And he said they've proposed the public option that would prevent that kind of thing from taking place. So I think this is something we need to watch. I trust that Trump does want to rebuild America. Our infrastructure is crumbling. But how he goes about doing it, if he's able to do so, is something I think we really want to keep an eye on. You go ahead.
I apologize.
That's okay. I'm asthmatic, and when I talk too much, this is what happens.
Yeah, I'm actually very, very more optimistic about Trump in different ways. I think he will. I think he's serious about rebuilding. He's done things in his life which actually more so than Hillary and Obama. He actually has been built buildings and something, some sort of thing. So he has accomplished something in his life. I believe he might intend, I don't know, I can't read his mind, but I believe he might be more interested in privatizing Social Security, which apparently both of you disagree with.
It's a disaster. I'm sorry.
But I'm saying I believe, if I had to make a prediction, I believe he will privatize. I believe also, I don't think he's for the single payer of Obama, because apparently both of you would also disagree with that also. I can't read his mind, but I suspect that he probably would have Ben Carson.
My God.
I'm saying if I had to make a prediction into the future, but being more realistic here,
Carson,
I think he probably would.
Carson,
who did challenge Obama, by the way.
Carson turned down a cabinet post this morning.
Wonderful. Well, that's good
news.
Okay,
then I stand corrected there, but yeah, I suspect that he probably would use some of Ben Carson's ideas. I could be wrong
not
here.
A good
Ben
thing.
Carson have ideas?
Well, yeah, no. Because he did challenge Obama by right into his face. You know, I mean,
yeah,
I
was really fearful that he was going to put him in charge of of health care or something.
Anyway,
because he's a doctor.
I understand.
But, yeah, no, I'm glad to hear
that. I'm trying to be realistic about where I believe he might really go rather than where you want him to go. I don't believe he's for the single payer.
Good.
And I can't speak exactly what he intends to replace it with. I believe he is serious about getting rid of Obamacare. What he's getting replaced with, I don't know precisely.
There are a lot of people that will be rising up against Trump going out based upon the issues if he does privatize Medicare, if he does privatize Social Security.
Yep.
Unfortunately, there'll be older people like us, and what will the young people do? And unless we, because of the reforms what has taken place, I think young people are focused, my fear is that they're focused too much on identity politics. And I think this is a problem we have now. This is what I saw after the election. People protesting against a person. And this is why I keep coming back and saying, no, we need to really focus on the issues, the policy issues.
This is a very good point. And here's a piece from Diana Johnstone, who is very clever on things like this, commenting on the point that Karen just made. Johnstone writes, in 2016, the fundamentally undemocratic U.S. two-party system presented the public with the two most hated candidates in history. The choice was so dismal that over 43% of the voters could not bring themselves to go to the polls. Everyone hated one or the other of the candidates, or both. Whoever won was bound to face vehement opposition. The unexpected shock of Donald Trump's victory created mass hysteria, with crowds in tears going into the streets to protest. An unprecedented reaction to an uncontested election. This hysterical opposition is not the best basis for building the new movement needed to oppose a widely rejected political establishment, just the point Karen was making. Most of the weeping and wailing comes not from Bernie Sanders supporters, who were prepared for the worst, but from those who believed the Clinton campaign claim that Trump represents nothing but various ways to hate other people. Sexism, racism, homophobia, xenophobia, etc. The response is to hate Trump. This is sterile and gets nowhere politically. Trump's reputation as a racist fiend is largely based on excessive remarks, such as his outrageous promise to build a wall to keep Mexican immigrants from entering the country. Outrageous, in fact, because the wall already exists, except that it was called a fence. And it was built by the first Clinton administration. Washington is not about to be ruled by Nazis, but by reactionary Republicans, which are bad enough, but nothing new. If Trump is better than they are on some points, that should be noted and encouraged. An effective opposition should know how to distinguish between hot air and real issues, and to judge issues on their own specific merits. The Clinton campaign was based on identity politics, the claim to protect women and minorities from their enemy, Trump. An opposition movement based on perpetuating that claim, with emphasis on how horrible Trump must be personally, is also likely to swallow other aspects of the Clinton campaign line, notably its anti-Russian propaganda. Incited by the mainstream media, the left, in quotes, the left opposition risks echoing the Clintonist accusation that, quotes again, dictator Trump is too friendly with, quotes again, dictator Putin. This is amazing. I must admit, for someone who lived through the McCarthy era, I'm just astonished that this stuff has emerged it requires some explanation. Diana Johnstone continues, the hysterical opposition will oppose the one positive element in Trump's campaign, the desire to make business rather than war with Russia. It's significant that the German defense minister, Ursula von der Leyen, wasted no time in demanding that Trump choose between friendship with Putin on the one hand, or NATO and our shared values, as she said, on the other. Europe is worried. This is a sign that not only the U.S. war party, but also the European NATO machine will be putting pressure on Trump to pursue the very same warlike policies favored by Hillary Clinton. And the disappointed Clintonite opposition is likely to be out in the streets not to oppose wars, but to oppose Trump's opposition to wars, all in the name of our shared democratic humanitarian values and opposition to dictators. That's right. That seems to me to be exactly what's going on and suggests the Orwellian nature of the political discussion, not only during the campaign, but even more importantly after it. Diana Johnstone concludes, "This is the danger of hysterical opposition to Trump. It would be a continuation of the worst aspects of this dreadful campaign, totally centered on denouncing individuals and neglecting serious political questions. A progressive opposition should leave Clintonism behind and develop its own positions, starting with opposition to regime change wars, even if Trump is also against regime change wars." Horrors. "And indeed, it should push Trump to maintain that position because he will be under strong pressure in Washington to give it up." And that's what I think we're seeing in today's news. "The opposition should demand that Trump make good on his promise to avoid war while opposing his reactionary domestic policies. Otherwise, we're heading for the worst of both worlds." That seems to me to be precisely right.
Yeah. Well, one of my concerns, too, is that a lot of people are grabbing onto this, oh, we have to reform the Democratic Party.
Mm-hmm.
And I just keep, and then they talk about, they actually talk about bringing out a younger candidate, one who appeals to younger people. And I'm like, what is this? Yeah, this is cosmetic, for God's sakes. Mm-hmm. And let's face it, the majority of Democrats were going for Bernie, who is hardly younger. He's an older guy, and yet he was the one that the people really wanted, and he was sidelined. But they wanted him because he was speaking substance, and that was the issue, I think, that when he was sidelined kept a lot of Democrats at home. Now, here's what I want to point on that. I believe the Democratic Party and the Republican Party are owned and controlled by the same 1% elite, and I think it's time that, I mean, I see it as good cop and bad cop, that the people really need, the working class and the people really need a party of our own. Would also like to recommend a book here, Who Rules the World by Noam Chomsky. This is his most recent, so it's a little more up to date. He mentions some things here. For me, the most important thing is getting the details as to who actually rules the world. It is complex, and it's a lot of corporate military groups and organizations, as we've talked about before. Carl, I do have one question here. You're a historian. Maybe you can respond to this. Throughout history...
That may be a disability, but go ahead.
No, because I think it's true. Whenever policies of austerity are imposed upon people, my fear is usually that's when we get populist, as we call them, and often that's when we end up with fascism. At least that's the way I'm viewing it. You would know better than I. When has the imposition of austerity ever brought about progress? I mean, I think we're looking at the potential for that now, if the people are now awakened, rise up, and insist that our newly elected president do what the people actually want. If that occurs, that would be progress. But where in history has that occurred in the past?
Well, that's a very good question, and I'm not even sure if we would educe an example or two. It would be much help with our present situation. It might be better to look at where we are and how those sorts of demands can be translated into action. I have in mind particularly a study that is now almost 2 years old, Gillens and Page study of the effectiveness of political action in the U.S. These are two guys, two political scientists, one at Princeton, one at Northwestern. Normally, I don't have a great deal of enthusiasm for political scientists, but they've done a very interesting study here using the techniques such as they are of the political science research, and they try to decide whose political ideas, as it were, get listened to, get put into shape, put into action. And they examined a wide range of questions across the country, a wide range of groups and so forth, and they found, to their own surprise, that the answer was remarkably skewed, that the groups and individuals whose political interests, concerns, and demands actually were listened to and enacted were the wealthy, the most wealthy. So much so that with the concentration of wealth that's occurred in this country over the last two generations, what we have in the country is no longer a democracy, if we ever had a democracy at all, said Gillens and Page, but an oligopoly, that is a rule by the rich, by the rich few. And that this was not a theoretical conclusion, which you could find from the Greeks on, so to speak, about the dangers of oligopoly, but a, as it were, statistical conclusion from the examination of American politics. I think that's exactly right, and I think that what we see in the election we've been talking about is a revolt against that. And well, the question is how that revolt will be put into practice, put into action, or whether it can be defeated by the by the rulers of the oligopoly.
I was just going to say one more thing in response, and that is
one
of the reasons this book by Chomsky is important is because he goes back and he refers to Adam Smith referring to who ruled the world then. It was the, or masters of mankind, the manufacturers and the merchants. But today, the masters of mankind are a broad spectrum, which I will leave it at that and let Ed have something to say.
There are so many issues you brought up. I don't know where to begin.
Ed, you get the final comment.
Well, I mean, I was just going to mention. Maybe I'll just let you conclude. I'll bring it some other time. No problem.
Go ahead. We'll get you to come back next week and continue the conversation. You've been watching Aware on the Air, presented by members and friends of Aware, the anti-war, anti-racism effort of Champaign-Urbana, a local peace group, in the 46th week of 2016. Another week in which the world can see that the most extensive global terrorism is not made up of just the attacks by ISIS and its sympathizers in New York, Baghdad, Bangladesh, Orlando, Brussels, Nigeria, Somalia, or Istanbul, terrible as they are, but by President Obama's drone assassination program, which has killed thousands and is paralleled by overwhelming police killings in the U.S., far beyond what happens in other countries. Our show is produced and directed by Jason Liggett and Yosef Cash, thanks to whom also this program and others like it will be available on YouTube, and see our Facebook page, the Facebook page for Aware, for articles referred to and upcoming events. Finally, Aware honors those who reveal the crimes of the U.S. government, which the rest of the world knows about but Americans don't, Manning, Assange, Snowden, and others, who are being persecuted by the Obama administration. Now, this is Carl Easterbrook for Karen Arum, Karen Evans Levy, Stuart Levy, David Green, David Johnson, and the prophet Ed Mandel, saying in the words of the late Edward Murrow, good night and good luck.